Now let us recollect what happens when we do when we use PySpark. As I have Spark installed locally on my local PC itself, I am launching PySpark. Today, in contrast to past few days, I am not running PySpark on the lab. I am running on my PC itself. I have a local copy of Spark on my PC so that I can develop applications on my PC and then deploy it on the cluster. Okay. But for past few days, I just demonstrated on the cluster so that you understand the concepts related to distributed computing leveraging Spark. Okay. Now you see, when we use PySpark like this, it creates an object called SC. And what is the type of that SC? It is nothing but our context. So when we actually say PySpark, it actually launches Python based command line interface with all the Spark binaries integrated with it. Okay. On top of these things, with Python CLI with Spark binaries, it also creates a web service called Spark context. Okay. And that is automatically taken care for you. The advantage of this is, if you want to write and validate your logic to get the proper logic and use that proper logic as part of the main application, as you are using the existing Spark context, it will be much faster to interact with the Spark context and come up with the logic compared to using IDE and rerun again and again, which will start the Spark context again and again, which wastes the time. You will understand that once we proceed further. Okay. So here, as SC is already available and SC is of the Spark context, I can say orders equal to SC dot text file, and I can give the path to my files and it will work. Okay. Whereas when you try to develop applications, the Spark context is not available. You have to create that, and to create that, first you need to have the Spark binaries configured with your IDE. We have already done that, and we have to import the classes related to creating the Spark context. Spark context depends upon Spark configuration. First we need to create configuration object, and then we have to create context object. That's why I have imported configuration object, and then we will be using this configuration object to create Spark context object. Okay. Now let us say conf equal to Spark conf. So I am creating a Spark configuration object, and when you manually try to create the context, as part of creating Spark configuration object, you have to set a couple of properties, and one of the properties is set master and the other property is set app name. Without these two things, you will not be able to create the context object. Okay. Here I am breaking into multiple lines, and automatically it will add these things. That is the advantage of IDE. Okay. So when it comes to master, we have to tell whether you want to run in local mode or YARN mode or whatever it is. Other supported modes are Mesos and standalone. But we'll be seeing local mode and YARN mode in detail. In this case, let us hard code with local, and then we also have to give the app name, and the app name is Daily Revenue. Okay. So now the configuration object is created. Using this configuration object is nothing but properties which control the Spark context runtime behavior. Okay. On top of these two APIs, such as setMaster and setAppName, which are mandatory, which are used to set mandatory properties. If you want to add more properties, for example, we have been using a unique port every time when we launch PySpark from command line. If you want to set a unique port even for your program, you can use set. You can see here there is a API called set. Okay. And that set takes two arguments. The first one is key, which is nothing but conf.ui.port, and then value is whatever port number you want to run. Let's say I want to run on 12901. Like this, we can set many properties to control the runtime behavior. Set app name and set master are actually two different properties similar to this, but instead of remembering these property names, we can just use these APIs. So as these are very commonly used properties, they have provided APIs for this. Okay. That's the only difference between this and this. We don't need to remember the property name. And by having methods like this, when we use IDEs, we can get the information automatically for us. Even from command line, we can use help and we can get these API details. Okay. That's the advantage of having this set master and set app name. You can also replace this set master with set. You need to identify the appropriate property for master. And first one should be the name related to that property, and value can be local or YARN client, etc. Same is the case with app name. Okay. So these two are just handy APIs, which eliminates us to remember the actual property names to set master and app name. Once you have configuration object with multiple properties predefined, And only mandatory properties are master and app name. You can customize others also. Once you have this, now you can create a Spark context object, okay? And it has a constructor which takes a keyword argument called const, and you can pass this configuration object which you have created to this. So this is keyword argument name, and this is the actual argument which we are passing to this keyword argument called const. So using this configuration, we are trying to create this Spark context, okay? Now the Spark context will be created, and we should be able to process the data. If you use APIs such as text file, which creates RDD, and by going through APIs on top of RDD, we can process the data depending upon our problem statement. To just to demonstrate how to run this, I will read orders data here, and I will be using sc.txt file, and then on my local PC, the path is users, Cytiversity, research, data, retail DB, orders. So this is the location where I have my data set, and for now I'm just getting count of it, okay? And let me pass it to print. Because it is of type integer, we have to convert into string type so that we can actually print the count. Otherwise it might not work. And now you can run daily revenue, and you see it is taking some time to launch the Spark context on port number 4040, and then it actually displayed the results. It took around 5-10 seconds, okay? Instead of using REPL, if you start developing the code here, and if you have to run to validate your code, every time you run, it has to create this Spark context, and it can take a considerable amount of time. And hence, using REPL might be a bit more productive if you want to come up with small logics before you embed it as part of the main application. That's why you should be comfortable with both REPL and also IDE. And also, if you are planning to give certification of Hortonworks or Cloudera, which are scenario based, it is better to be comfortable with REPL so that you don't run into any IDE related issues as part of taking the exam, okay? But if you want to build applications, if you are good at programming, if you run only after writing considerable amount of code, if you limit the number of times you run your program, probably using IDE is good enough, okay? As we have validated creation of Spark context by reading data for our orders and printing it, now we can copy paste our daily revenue code from day before yesterday's session. So if you go back to the basic transformations and actions, and if you go to get daily revenue, there is a gist here. I can take this, okay? Then I can copy paste here. I can delete this. For order items also, I just have to change the path like this. Rest of the logic is same. We don't need to worry about it, except for the output path. The output path also, I need to give the local path, not the path on my cluster. Okay. So in this case, I am saying research data bootcamp Spark. So this is the directory where I want to write the output to. Okay. Now as we have the complete logic where we read orders data, order items data, filter for complete and closed orders, and then apply transformations to get order ID and order date from orders so that we can join with order items based on order ID. And then we got order ID and order item subtotal from order items. Once we get order ID and order date from orders and order ID and order item subtotal from order items, using order ID as key, we have performed the join here. On top of join data, we discarded order ID and we got order date and order item subtotal here, okay? And then using order date as key, we actually added the order item subtotals to get the revenue, okay? And then we sorted the data in ascending order by date. Because the output will be in the form of tuples, I want to change it to comma separated strings, and hence I applied map after sorting the data to convert tuples like this to the comma separated values of date and revenue, okay? That logic is applied here as part of this map, okay? And then finally, I'm using save as text file to save the output to the file system. Now you right click on it and run it. If there are any bugs, we'll fix. Otherwise, we are good to go. Now you can see that the job is running and it is done. As long as we get the exit code 0, we are good to go. We don't need to worry too much about it. All we need to do is we have to go to this location and see if the files exist. Okay. So I'm going to this location, and you can see the files. We can see the data where we have order date and revenue for that date. Okay. As we have validated this, and keep one thing in your mind, whenever you have to develop the code. Never ever hard code these things. So there are several things which are hard coded here. Even if someone conducts a hackathon, or even if you go to an interview and give a scenario, it will make a significant difference, or it will leave a different type of impression if you parameterize it. So if time is a constraint, it's a different story. But if you have enough time after hard coding these paths, if it work, it will be better to parameterize them or externalize them. So there is a difference between passing them as arguments or loading them from external properties file at runtime and use them. With this approach, if I have to run it on my cluster by copying this code, it will not work because these paths are not correct on my cluster. Also, the set master to use the distributed cluster, to use the Spark cluster, I have to run it in yarn mode. Okay, I cannot run it in local mode and expect to run on all the nodes in the cluster. So to change this to change the behavior of your jobs in different environments such as development, testing, production, etc., you should not hard code these values. Either you have to externalize as properties, or you have to pass them as argument. Okay, so there is one valid question from Landry: is it possible to run it on the cluster from the IDE? So even if it is possible, I'm not sure, Landry, but even if it is possible, you should not run on the cluster directly using the IDE. Cluster, you need to consider it as a production environment, and IDEs are primarily for development. And once you develop locally, you are supposed to validate locally. Okay, you should not connect to a production cluster or testing cluster and run your jobs over there. Okay. If you have a development cluster, then yeah, probably you can, if there is a way, you can actually connect to the cluster and run the jobs. But I don't think there is a way to use your IDEs to directly connect to your development cluster. Use your IDE, validate locally, externalize the properties. Once it is tested using IDE in local mode, then you can ship it to a cluster, and you have to use Spark Submit to validate your jobs, and then you have to roll out the tested code into testing test environment, production environment, etc. Okay, as far my knowledge goes, Landry, I don't think it is possible to connect to the cluster directly from IDE. Even if there is a way to connect to the cluster, I don't recommend to do so. Okay, develop using IDE, validate using IDE in local mode, then ship it to the cluster and run on the cluster. There are many other challenges which might run, which you might encounter to run your jobs directly onto the cluster. Your operating system on the PC has to be this in some cases. Not I am not sure about Spark, but with respect to Hadoop, if you want to use Eclipse and run Hadoop jobs, the operating system on your PC has to be the same as all the nodes in the cluster. So there will be so many other challenges like that. Okay, so that being said, avoid as much as possible to connect to the cluster directly from IDE and run it. Validate use in local mode, and then ship it to the cluster and run it using Spark Submit.